person that even hated his own race. He can understand. It's like to use the vernacular. In the world today, we have the reds and the blues. We have those called, you know. If you're in a red area, and if it's in a red area, and you're white, wearing your blue stuff in a red area, they can shoot you.
Yeah.
You can just have it. You can have your boom. You know, because you're in the red area. What are you wearing all blue in the red area for? Maybe you are just going around and then you are lost, or you are trying to ask somebody directions, but you are not blue, but the red area, you are in trouble. Or maybe you are in the blue area and then you are wearing all red. You are going to hear some guns of boom, because they will be thinking maybe you came to do something, to start something. So before you start anything, they are going to, you know, do something to you. So it's like that one, one of the way to Jericho. It was somebody, a Samaritan, and the Jewish people. They are not friends. It was the opposite person that even came and helped him. That's a righteous person. That was a righteous person. And if you are righteous, you do holy things. When you are righteous, you'll be able to help your sister and brother. When you are righteous, you are not going to be looking for the downfall of the other one. When you are righteous, you are not going to be going on the phone and speak all day. Oh, do you know they have a new pastor in that church right now? And that pastor, no, I don't even think it's going to last for a minute. And then, you know, the pastor's wife right now, she bought her a new Mercedes Benz. I'm not going to be putting my money on the offering anymore. You start saying all kind of stuff. Do you know Sister Susan so-and-so? And then I went to see something that she did last week, and she did, and they start talking about members of the church. We are supposed to be brothers and sisters.
Amen.
But because we don't have righteousness, we don't have holiness, so we just badmouth each other, and we crucify each other.
Amen.
So when we do that, we can't get this type of crown.
Amen.
We cannot.
Speak
to read, to get this type of righteousness, we need to start now. We need to look in our environment, to look in our homes. You know that, forget talking about the pastor or members of the church. You know that some people talk about their own family. Some people talk about their own husband or their own wife. Oh, do you know, blah, 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 on the phone. Their own people that they are supposed to love each other, but we crucify our own family members. So look, this is a test. This is a test of righteousness and holiness. If you are on the phone for 1 hour speaking to somebody, write down what you will be saying. If you cannot summarize what you will be saying, get on the phone.
Amen. Amen.
Just get on the phone. If you are on the phone for 1 hour, talking to your best friend, your girlfriend, your boyfriend, or whoever you are talking to, you will be talking for 1 hour. And then you cannot write down what you will be saying for all that. You know what you will be doing? Gossiping.
Amen.
I know what gossip is.
Amen.
Something that is telling somebody else on. Something that is going to make you don't get this crown.
Preach, Pastor.
That's what you've been doing.
Amen.
You know, we talk and talk and I'm calling my life, but my phone is dying. Yeah, that phone is to be dead.
So is the spirit. Amen.
And then go and tie, and then tie it again, and then have more energy. Oh, girlfriend.
Jesus.
And guess what? I'm sweating already right now. Guess what? I thought it was women. Now it's men. Man, look, men in the past, now you thought, hey man, 2 minutes, you know, 1 minute, it's all about before. Yeah. But a man to be talking to another man for 1 hour? That don't make sense. So please, let us watch what we say.
Amen.
This is between both sides, both men and women.
Amen.
Because no way. Now they have all you can do talking, all you can do texting, all you can do everything. You know, you have it's all free. You know, just.
Amen.
But we need to get this crown. And we need to start working on it now. We do read the verse for that one. Finally, they laid up for me, verse 8. And finally, they laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which is laid. What the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on the day, and not only to me, but also to all those who have loved his appearing. So,
Amen.
God is going to say, it's not only for him. It's is for you and me.
Amen.
If we love the Lord Jesus Christ, we know that he's going to come again. And what are we doing? Look, let me tell you this. Why are you here in this world? Why?
Purpose.
Why are you a Christian? Why? You're not a Christian to come in here and to do Bible studies and then want to sit down and then want to because you've studied some things, you want to show off that you know this passage and that passage and this one and that one. Some people do that. You know, they come in to Bible studies, they are prepared. They memorize some things. They want to show off that I know the word of God. That's not why you're a Christian. That's not why you're a Christian. We are Christians for one thing and one thing only. To sow seeds.
Amen.
To sow seeds. So that other people, you know, the Great Commission, in Matthew and Mark, so that other people can come into the fold. If whatever you are doing, you are not bringing people into the fold, my sister, my brother, you miss it.
Mm-hmm. Amen. Amen.
We are Christians for one thing and one thing only. To sow seeds. People will know that. Number one, if people don't know you are a Christian, please go on a 3-day fast and go ask God to forgive you. Because there are some people that are Christians, their neighbors don't know they are Christians. Oh, we don't know you are a Christian. If somebody tells you, I don't know you are a Christian, you need to go and cry to God because something is wrong with you.
Amen.
If somebody says, oh, person, so you are a Christian. Which means the life you've been living is a false life. Which means that when you go to the world, you blend with them. So by the time you say, oh, so he's a Christian. So she's a Christian. I didn't know. I've lived with you for 2 years. I didn't know I was a Christian. That one has given Christ a bad name. People must know that you're a Christian. You must be not obnoxious, but must let people know. You must have the opportunity that you have. You must be able to tell them, hey, do you know we are doing something at church tomorrow? Do you know we have this? People will say, okay, there comes that Christian, you know. If they know you like that, good. Because I tell them you are Christian. But if they don't know you like that, that you are Christian, then you are not working for any of these rewards. But you have to be a Christian. Your people have to know. If your family don't know you are a Christian, then you are in trouble. Your family don't know you are a Christian. If your people in your job don't know you are a Christian, you are in trouble.
Amen.
Because some people, they work in the same place for years. I'm not saying go in there and be carrying Bible around your workplace. I'm not saying you should go and get fired. That's not what I'm saying.
Right.
But people must know you are a Christian in your job.
Amen.
People must know that, oh, that's that person so and so. Okay, I don't know him so much, but I'm going through some things. Hey, brother, I don't know you, but can you help me? I'm having a problem with my wife.
Amen.
I'm having a problem with my children.
Amen.
They may not even be your speaking bodies, but they know that that brother, that sister is a Christian.
Amen.
And in your own job place, you'll be shocked. You'll be surprised. The ones that are going to come to you.
Amen.
But you don't speak. You just, hey, bro, just hire and go and buy. But you don't work in the same department. But they know you. They know you carry something. They know you carry that ammunition of Jesus Christ. They know that the Holy Spirit is with you.
Amen.
So when they need help, they come straight to you.
Amen.
On the other hand, if you have been in the same job, when you go to the break room, you are the first one that say all kind of four-letter words.
Mm-hmm.
You are the first one that talks about some naked women body. You are the first one that do all those type of things that you do right there in the break room. And then one day, hey, Sister John, my church is having something. What church? I don't want a church. You've been preaching all this time. Tonight, oh, church, you? I don't need your church. Because we've been giving, but we are living our life. The Bible that people are going to read is ours.
Amen.
People are looking at it every day.
Amen.
It may be difficult to be working for all these crowns, but once you ask your Father in heaven to help you,
Amen.
The Holy Spirit will be there.
Amen.
Amen.
But we cannot do it by ourselves. And that's why I said the Spirit of the Helper, the Holy Spirit, is going to help us. He's going to take us along. He's going to carry us along and do all those good things. There are some areas that is so difficult that God will carry us through that. To carry us through that time. Because we cannot do it at that particular time. But He is there to help us.
Amen.
The last one is give you the crown for our glory. No, we haven't done that. Let's go to the crown of glory, number 4. First Peter chapter 5, verse 2 to 4. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2 to 4. That's the crown of glory.
Wow.
Crown of glory. Yeah, that's the one that all church is it 1 Peter? 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2 to 4. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2 to 4. See, that crown of glory. See, that is the one that a lot of people are going to, a lot of church leaders. When I say church leaders, I'm not talking of the pastors only or the deacons. I'm talking of praise and worship. I'm talking if you hold a position in the church, a leadership position, you are working towards that. You may be the one in charge of the tithes and offering. You may be the one who, when you do tithes and offering, you are the accountant, and when it was, how much money do you need? Oh, let's call Brother Philip. He knows exactly what, how much money the church has. He takes it down there, you know, religiously. He goes to the bank with it. He doesn't take some of it and put some of it in his pocket, of which some people do, unfortunately, all over the world. People take tax money and put it in their pocket. I thought it was only in Africa. When I got to this country, I said, oh, they are doing it down there too? It's all over the world. They take tithe offering, they take some tithes, they help themselves with tithes, they put the rest of it in. You cannot get any crown by doing all those things. You cannot get the crown of glory. Let's see that one. See, yeah, I like that picture. The crown of glory. See, that's our 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 24. See, this is for godly leaders who are examples to the flock, for godly leaders. See, 2-4 say, shepherd the flock of God which is among you, serving as overseers, not compulsion but willingly, not for dishonest gain,
amen,
but eagerly, not as being lost over those who are entrusted to you, but be examples to the
amen.
Flock. You have to be examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive the crown of glory.
Amen.
That does not fail in you. That crown does not fail. We should not love. We should not. Do you know that you know, in the Christendom right now? No. Let me just tell you this news to you. In the Christendom right now, we have some men of God, some women of God now that they think, you know, they are above everything now. You know, they've arrived. There's nothing wrong in God giving you a big flock and all that stuff, but the moment you want to start lording over them, people do it. Oh, it comes in. Who asked you to start that service without me being here first? I've seen it in the church. Why did you guys start doing something without me giving the okay before you start? This was for a planned event of which everything is supposed to be there. Because it's coming late, it's still fighting the flock. Why do you start with that? I've seen all this in the Christendom. They start lording over the flock. I say, without them, you know, some people think the church, they don't know that the church is belongs to Jesus Christ.
They Amen.
Think the church, see, the moment we start thinking, the church, this church is my church. It's not my church. It can never be my church. It's the church of Christ. He bare with it with his own blood.
Amen.
And then with the blood of the apostles and prophets, this foundation was laid on the blood of Christ.
Amen.
But the moment we start forgetting that this church does not belong to you, that's why a lot of mega churches today, good churches, but they start thinking, this is my church. Never your church.
Amen.
Does not belong to that man of God, does not belong to that woman of God.
Amen.
And that's why today we see a lot of churches, big churches, they crumble. They started, they crumble.
Amen.
But by the time you start thinking, the foundation is you.
Amen.
The lampstand is
Amen.
You.
Amen.
We're not in the book of Revelation. The lampstand is you. But God is so merciful.
Yes.
He loves all his men and women that is standing on the pulpit that is doing this work.
Amen.
But guess what? This flesh, the flesh is very nasty.
Amen.
It deceives us, the flesh. If you let it deceive you. And that's why God says, because of the saints, the time for that Christ going, the time we are going to go through on tribulation, the tribulation time is cut short because of the saints. Because Christ is looking at it that if you let the tribulation period to be long, then a lot of things are going to happen. God is going to cut it short. That's why I said 3.5 years, all those are. But if God were to prolong the tribulation period, a lot of people will suffer. Believers will suffer. Amen?
Amen.
So for leaders, so when it's talking of leaders, don't just put on the pastors only. Think of the praise and worship. Think of whatever department that you are in, that God has placed him in the church of God. You are a church leader. That scripture belongs to you. It's all of us that are leaders in church.
Amen.
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 And then the last one, is the crown of life. Let me hear everybody say that. Crown of life.
Crown of life.
One more time.
Crown of life.
One more time.
Crown of life.
You know what I ask you to say? This one, you can't work for it. This is the only one you don't work for. Let's see why. Okay. Go to James. It's in James and in Revelation. James chapter 1 verse 12. And then Revelation chapter 2 verse 10. Let's go to James first. James. So you cannot work for this one. It's a good one, but nobody works for it. You see why? The crown of life. James 1:12. What is it? James chapter 1 verse 12.
Amen.
James 1:12. And after that, we are going to be looking at Revelation chapter 2:10. So, ready?
Amen.